Hi, this is Annie Dance. Please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter, where I'm working to shine a light on police and policy issues in North Carolina and beyond. Today, Wednesday, May 15th, 2024, let's see what lawmakers are saying with today at the NCGA. They're about to take up possible actions against a very important bill.
Right after 198. Not objection. Public bill, second reading, House Bill 198. Clerk will read.
House Bill 198, DOT, Legislative Changes, AB.
Senator Lazar is recognized to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the committee. House Bill 198. Is the first of two agency bills that we plan to run this session. I'll just go over a couple important provisions. First, we have the removal of unnecessary reporting requirements that department has found to be onerous, the creation of and expansion of pilot programs for the new procurement methods that the department believes will help save them time and money. Number three, the revision of the Build NC Bond Act to help the department with project delays in the face of escalating construction costs. And we made changes to the Outdoor Advertisement Act as negotiated by the department. And we have many other changes that are requested by the department. We've been working closely with the secretary for the last few months in order to get to where we are today, and I would ask for your support.
Discussion or debate? Hearing none, question for the Senate is the passage of House Bill 198 on its second reading. All in favor would vote aye, all opposed vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Senator Overcash? Aye. 31 having voted in the affirmative, 13 in the negative. House Bill 198 has passed its second reading and will, without objection, be read a third time.
The General Assembly of North Carolina enacts.
Is there discussion or debate on third reading? Hearing none, question for the Senate is the passage on third reading of House Bill 198. All in favor will say aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and House Bill 198 has passed its third reading and will be returned to the House on the issue of concurrence. Members, the next bill on the list that I have is House Bill 237. Are we ready to hear that now? Senator Raven, what purpose your eyes?
A motion, please.
State your motion.
Thank you, Mr. President. No, we're not ready yet. If we could please displace 237 to the calendar following House Bill 834. My first motion, I was reading off my motions rather than off the calendar. Thank you.
Without objection, so ordered. House Bill 591, Clerk will read.
House Bill 591, Modernized Sex Crimes.
Senator Gailey is recognized to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill will create the new offense of sexual extortion, where a person threatens to disclose a private image in order to compel a victim to pay money or to do something else. Also, it updates definitions in the statutes related to sexual exploitation of a minor. It makes updates to the sex offender and public protection registration. And finally, it modifies provisions related to bringing a private civil action. I know of no opposition to this bill.
Discussion or debate? Hearing none, question for the Senate is passed on second reading of House Bill 591. All in favor will vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Senator Perry, aye. 44 having voted in the affirmative, none in the negative, House Bill 591 has passed its second reading and will, without objection, be read a third time.
The General Assembly of North Carolina enact.
Discussion or debate on third reading? Hearing none, question for the Senate is passage on third reading of House Bill 591. All in favor will say aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and House Bill 591 has passed its third reading and will be returned to the House on the issue of concurrence. House Bill 834, the clerk will read.
House Bill 834, Juvenile Justice Modifications.
Senator Britt's recognized to explain the bill.
Mr. President, members, House Bill 834 is a PCS that seeks to address several of the issues that we're dealing with in juvenile justice. This has been a bill that's been worked on with Juvenile Justice Committee, as well as the Conference of DAs and Administrative Office of the Courts. Tell the members that what this is a situation where we're trying to deal with these violent A through E felonies. We're trying to deal with these individuals that are mostly prosecuted in Superior Court, but through a lengthy transfer process, a very convoluted transfer process. What we're not doing is rolling back, raise the age. What we're doing is taking these cases that are mostly being prosecuted in Superior Court already and just putting these cases straight in Superior Court. That allows still for a district attorney and for a judge to still send these matters back down to juvenile court. This does not change where the juveniles are being housed at. These juveniles that are 16 and 17 that commit these A through E felonies are still to be housed in juvenile facilities. Again, this just helps make a process go smoother with the juveniles that are involved in violent crimes. There is also a provision in this bill that ensures that adults who are enticing minors to commit violent crimes are also punished for the enticement of those minors for committing violent crimes. Where this occurs mostly is when you have older gang members recruiting children to commit violent crimes for them, knowing that that 15, 16, 17-year-old, 14-year-old is less likely to face any type of justice. This ensures that adult that entices that minor to commit a crime is also punished for recruiting that minor to commit the crime. And there is a amendment that's on the dashboard.
Clerk will read.
Senator Britt moves to amend the bill.
Senator Britt's recognized to explain Amendment 1.
This amendment simply fell out in a drafting error. Whenever we ran the amendment, this language came through committee. Essentially what this amendment does, when a juvenile court counselor chooses to divert or defer a juvenile, meaning a juvenile court counselor decides they're not going to send the juvenile through the standard juvenile court process, but instead is going to work with that juvenile on other programs that would help that juvenile that's possibly committed a crime. What this says is that the victim that now has 5 days to reach out to the prosecutor to say, I don't think this is something that should be diverted or deferred. I think this is something that should be prosecuted. It gives that victim an additional 10 days to reach out to the DA and then the DA to make a decision rather not that case should be diverted. No, if no reasonable non-opposition to the amendment or the bill.
Discussion or debate on Amendment 1. Hearing none, question for the Senate is the adoption of Amendment 1 to House Bill 834. All in favor of the amendment would vote aye. All opposed, the vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Let the record reflect that Senator Lowe is in the chamber. Okay, Senator Corbin, aye. Senator Jarvis, aye. Senator Batch, aye. Senator Blue, aye. Senator Heiss, aye. Senator Lowe, aye. Senator Waddell, aye. Senator Sawyer, aye. And Senator McInnes, aye. I think that gets them all. 44 having voted in the affirmative, none in the negative. The amendment is adopted. Berger, aye. 45 having voted in the affirmative. The clerk distracted me. The amendment is adopted, and the bill is back before us. Senator Britt, to continue the explanation.
Mr. President, members, I just would like to thank Senator Muhammad for his work on this with juvenile justice and administrative office of the courts in the conference. I don't want to thank Madison Allgood. She's not with us anymore in judiciary. She did not help on this bill. But I would like to thank Brent Woodcox for his help. I commend the bill to you.
Discussion or debate? Hearing none. Question for the Senate is the passage on second reading of House Bill 834. All in favor will vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Senator Chaudhry, aye. 41, having voted in affirmative, 4 in the negative. House Bill 834 has passed its second reading and will, without objection, be read a third time.
The General Assembly of North Carolina in Act.
Is there discussion or debate on third reading? Hearing none. Question for the Senate is the passage on third reading of House Bill 834. All in favor will say aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and House Bill 834 has passed its third reading. The amendment will be engrossed. The bill will be returned to the House on the issue of concurrence. Senator Raven, are we ready to go on House Bill 237?
Yes, sir, we're ready to go.
House Bill 237, the clerk will read.
House Bill 237, unmasking mobs and criminals.
Senator Buck Newton is recognized to explain the bill. Senator Raven, your microphone is on. Senator Newton's recognized.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members, this is a common sense bill that we have fixed up for us in J committee. This deals with a couple of really simple common sense ideas. First off, we are repealing the COVID era mask exceptions to what the law was. We're returning to where we were pre COVID pandemic. Many of you, having heard some of the debate in committee, know that the genesis of the original legislation was to effectively ban secret societies such as the KKK. That's why it's located in that section of our general statutes. And the purpose of this is to basically prohibit people from using the excuse of wearing a mask in order to hide their identities so that they can do things that they shouldn't be doing. Breaking the law, disrupting things, intimidating people, much as we, this body, desired to stop back in the 50s, I believe it was, when this original language was adopted by, I think it was the Democrats who were in charge then, if I remember correctly. The other parts of the bill create some penalty enhancements for defendants who commit crimes, who are trying to hide their identity by masking or disguises or so forth. Another section of the bill, I believe section 3, deals with folks who intentionally are trying to block traffic during a demonstration. Excuse me, that's not section 3, I misspoke, that was section 4. So a person who willfully impedes traffic, first offense is an A1 misdemeanor, second or subsequent offenses are class H felonies. It also would make organizers of such blocking of traffic civilly and potentially criminally liable as well. Dialing back to Section 3, that limits the executive branch and local governments on their discretion of states of emergency. There's been a lot of discussion about this bill, a lot of concern. DHS raised some concerns, but even their analysis shows that returning to this era of where we were pre-COVID is not jeopardizing anybody's prosecution. I know there's a lot of concern about that. I ask you to consider the bill thoughtfully, and I commend it to you. Happy to answer any questions.
Discussion or debate? Senator Batch, for what purpose you rise?
To speak to the bill.
You have the floor.
I thank Senator Newton for bringing this bill forward and bringing some of the issues that we have seen over the years. And I also appreciate going back to the history of why the bill needed to actually be enacted. But I also know that many of us are dealing with issues that we never thought we would deal with, not in the 50s, not in the 60s, not in the 70s. We actually just went ahead and passed a bill in this chamber about modernizing our sex crimes and laws. And so what I would commend to you today is that while we were not in a position in which we were dealing with mass pandemics and other issues, one of the things that has been very clear over the years is that immunocompromised individuals are at risk. And the danger of passing this legislation as is will put them at risk. The National Health Interview Survey estimates that 6.6% of Americans are immunocompromised. If we use that same estimate and apply it to North Carolina, that means that 700,000 North Carolinians walk around every day worried about their safety. I was diagnosed, as many of you know, with breast cancer and was immunocompromised for a period of time. My children and my husband wore masks much longer than they wanted to and that I wanted them to do, but they did that because they wanted to protect me. This bill will criminalize their behavior and mine. And I'm actually very fortunate in the fact that I am not a person that walks around every single day immunocompromised in this state and in this country. And even after we've dealt with a massive pandemic where 30,000 North Carolinians died of COVID, we are now trying to turn back time and ignore science and allow individuals who want to protect themselves or to protect their loved ones from wearing a mask. During the COVID pandemic, 3 million North Carolinians ended up contracting COVID, and the numbers would have been much higher in death and infection had individuals not had the ability to wear masks. We talk a lot about freedoms in this chamber. I hear it all of the time. I should have the freedom, my children should have the freedom, and my husband should have the freedom to wear a mask in order to protect and save my life without fear of being arrested and charged with a Class 1 misdemeanor, which is exactly what this bill would do. And yet, while we stand here criminalizing immunocompromised people who choose to wear a mask, this bill actually continues to protect the KKK in one of those sections. And so while the Democrats might have had really great efforts in trying to protect the public with regards to the mask laws, what I would tell you is that we can continue to actually protect North Carolinians now with regards to removing the provisions that are in the bill right now that allow hate groups like the Ku Klux Klan to wear hoods in the streets. I truly do not understand how we are protecting hate groups who have the ability to walk around on our public streets in hoods, even if they're getting permission from the county commissions. I know, I've heard the arguments of they have to ask for permission. But if they are given permission, they can walk around without criminal implications. But none of us can. I find it really, really concerning. And I'm asking that you all join me in addressing and helping the immunocompromised individuals and their loved ones by amending this bill. And so with that, Mr. President, I ask to send forth an amendment.
Send forward your amendment. The clerk will read.
Senator Batch moves to amend the bill.
Senator Batch, hold on just a moment. I want to make sure it's up on the dashboard. Senator Batch is recognized to explain Amendment 1.
Thank you. And I would also just like to thank Senator Rabin for moving this bill out of order. Our amendments had not hit the floor yet, so I very much appreciate his willingness to do that. So the bill before you, as Senator Newton said, this is a common sense bill. Well, I've got a common sense amendment for you. This language has actually been worked through with the Department of Health and Human Services, and it would very much address the issue that I am actually speaking to for immunocompromised individuals. And so I ask that you guys look at this because it still allows for law enforcement officers and other individuals in the public to protect public safety, but allowing those who through no choice of their own are immunocompromised or their loved ones to continue to be safe and to not live in fear of dying or to be criminally charged. Thank you.
Discussion or debate on Amendment 1. Senator Heist, what purpose your eyes?
To move that Amendment 1 do lie upon the table.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that Amendment 1 lie upon the table. That is a non-debatable motion. We will go immediately to a vote. Question for the Senate is the motion to table Amendment 1. All in favor of the motion would vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting clerk. Record the vote. Having voted in the affirmative, 15 in the negative. The motion to table does carry, and Amendment 1 is tabled. And the bill is back before us. Discussion or debate on House Bill 237. Senator Grafstein, for what purpose you rise?
To speak to the bill, please.
You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to, without repeating some of the important points that Senator Batch has made, I want to just really emphasize the disbelief that we have been met with from our constituents and in our communities about the provision of this bill that would criminalize the wearing of a simple mask by people who are not wearing that mask to conceal their identity for criminal purposes, but literally anybody who walks in public, walks into a store, walks into any setting in a mask. That is now a class one misdemeanor if this bill passes. The disbelief that I'm hearing includes folks from the disability community and folks that I talk to every day. We have families with medically fragile children who are immunocompromised. These families are fighting every day for services and supports for their children. They're fighting every day to keep these children safe and healthy, and it's a struggle for them, even with the ability to mask in public. From that very serious situation, we also have just the everyday aspect that a lot of us have allergies. You might have noticed a lot of pollen around here. People have taken to wearing masks for things that simply make them more comfortable and healthier in their daily lives. And that maybe is something that we've learned from other countries during the course of COVID. We've taken on wearing masks for various health reasons. That's something that's been done in other countries for many years. It's become a practice here that most people find it incomprehensible that we would make illegal. Wearing a mask is simply about the ability to care for one's own health. It's about, as Senator Batch alluded to, medical freedom. And I think one of the things that really strikes me is the extent to which this body has taken steps to dictate what people do with their bodies and how they take care of their own bodies. We've seen that in the context of how we are regulating the availability of abortion, and now we are seeing it simply in people trying to live their lives and not get sick or not make others sick. I will tell you, one of the things that that was said in committee was that, well, you know, some people, it's obvious that some people are just, you know, grandmas in Walmarts who are not going to be harassed because they're wearing a mask, even though it's now a class one misdemeanor. But I will tell you, I work with people with disabilities, and one of the things that people with disabilities are sick and tired of is people questioning them about their disability, questioning about their needs in public. It's none of anybody's business what somebody's health condition is, and to the extent this leads to those kinds of inquiries, it's unconscionable. These are not mobs and criminals. These are human beings trying to live their lives in public. So addressing, I think, what I've heard as the intent of this bill, which is simply to address folks who are hiding their identity through a mask intentionally because they're engaged in criminal behavior, I have an amendment I'd like to offer that will address that issue.
Send forward your amendment. Clerk will read.
Senator Grafstein moves to amend the bill.
Senator Grafstein is recognized to explain Amendment 2.
Thank you, Mr. President. Amendment 2 simply changes this bill in a way, or changes the statute in a way, that addresses the concerns about people hiding their identity in order to conceal, or to wear a mask in order to conceal their identity for criminal or nefarious purposes. I certainly have no objection to the portions of this bill that have criminal implications for people who are trying to conceal their identity because they are engaged in criminal behavior. There's broad support, and I personally am in favor of ensuring that when you have groups like Proud Boys or others who are concealing their identity in the commission of crimes or violence, that those folks be punished accordingly. What this amendment does is simply clarify the definition so that when sections 12.7 through 12.10, in the places where it simply indicated before that if a person is considered in violation when they are disguised so as to conceal identity, the language would change to make the intent clear that they are liable only when they are disguised for the sole purpose of concealing identity. In other words, it would reinstate an exception that would allow people to wear masks for health reasons, so long as those reasons are not about criminal behavior or concealing their identity. So I would ask that you agree with this amendment to effectuate the purpose of the bill insofar as the criminal law is concerned, but does not criminalize people with disabilities or others who are protecting their health. Thank you.
Discussion or debate on Amendment 2. Senator Heist, what purpose your eyes?
To move that Amendment 2 do lie upon the table.
Second.
Been moved and seconded that Amendment 2 be tabled. Non-debatable motion. We will go immediately to vote. Question for the Senate. Is the motion to table Amendment 2. All in favor of the motion would vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting clerk. Record the vote. Having voted in the affirmative, 15 in the negative. The motion does carry, and Amendment 2 is tabled, and the bill is back before. Senator Britt, your light is on. You be recognized.
Yes, Mr. President.
You have the floor.
Mr. President, I would like to just point out a couple things. First, if you go to dictionary.com, you can look up the dictionary of disguised or disguising, both as verb or noun. If you look it up as noun, that which disguises something that serves or is intended for concealment of identity, as a verb, to change the appearance or guise of, as to conceal identity. If you look back, Mr. President, members, to 14-12.7, every one of these statutes have a preface that says that the wearing of a mask must be done so as to conceal the identity of the wearer. And what I believe that to say is that such a legal interpretation would indicate that wearing a mask for public health and safety is not, in fact, a crime. And removal of the explicit exception does not open anyone up for prosecution. And not only do I believe this, but the email we received from Department of Human Services, Health and Human Services, their folks apparently agree with this too, because that's where that language came from. They do believe that they have concerns about the implications, and I understand there is some disbelief by some of your constituents. Part of that might be because of their lack of understanding of the law, but hopefully you could point them to this and make sure that they understand that so as to conceal the identity of the wearer, so long as they are not concealing their identity, intentionally concealing their identity, they are not in violation of this law. So, in fact, the exception is unnecessary. I commend the bill to you, and Mr. President, thank you.
Further discussion or debate? Senator Marcus, for what purpose your eyes?
To debate the bill.
You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. What did we learn from the COVID pandemic? We lost a lot of people. One of the things I hope we learned is how we all impact each other. How when you're sick, you can make someone else sick too. And we learned that there are a lot of people in our society who we come in contact with who are particularly vulnerable to that kind of sickness. And here we are today, criminalizing the decision to protect oneself, not to mention those around you. This is a deeply disturbing decision. Why are you doing this? Is it really that you find masked chemo patients that threatening? Is there something about them that really makes you angry? Or is this more likely a desire to score some political points with the anti-mask crowd during an election year? At the expense, I must say, of vulnerable people. If you don't want to protect yourself and others, if you have a contagious illness, that's one thing. I think it's unwise, but that's one thing. But to stop other people from making that choice is really next level. Do you know anyone who is immunocompromised? Because I do. They've been writing to my office. They've been writing to your office since you proposed this terrible idea, and I'm wondering if you've read those messages. Here are just three examples of messages that I received at my office from North Carolinians who adamantly opposed this bill. Daniel M. Wake County. He wrote and said, quote, I'm writing to ask you to vote against House Bill 237. I'm a young voter, 19 years old, with health conditions that require me to wear a mask in public for my safety. People like me are already unfairly marginalized by society, and this dangerous bill would put us in outright danger. The unfortunate, often ignored truth is that COVID is still a threat and it's still disabling people. And here's the great part of what he said. The Unmasking Mobs and Criminals Bill, quotes around the title of your bill, doesn't just unmask mobs and criminals. It unmasks everyone, including those who need to wear a mask to protect themselves. Second example, Stacy S. from my district. She has a daughter with serious medical challenges, but she, the mom, still wants to be able to go to school board meeting last night, for example, to advocate for policy changes, and honestly, just to be out in the world in her normal life for other reasons. And so she always wears a mask when she's in public to reduce the chance that she will bring home an infection that could literally kill her daughter. Third person, Catherine C., resident of Mitchell County, wrote to all of us to express her, quote, strong opposition to repealing the health and safety exemption in House Bill 237. She says, I've been severely disabled by long COVID and rely on respirator masks in public for my personal safety, as another infection of any type would be potentially deadly or further disabling for me. And she warns that if you pass this bill, your constituents will realize that, quote, you have stripped them of their personal liberties and the ability to protect themselves and their families in these challenging times. That's just three examples. There's so many more from people who are worried about the risks inherent in their jobs, for example, where they have to come into contact with a lot of people, immunocompromised people just in everyday life. And then folks who are worried about the next pandemic or the next H5N1 that's coming our way, or the whooping cough, which is making a resurgence in Western North Carolina and in Mecklenburg County, where I am. I've responded to these folks. And I've told them, whether they live in my district or not, and I've explained to them that we are doing all we can to get the bill sponsors to understand the problems that they're talking about and to get you to change this bill. And that includes what I'm doing right now. The bill sponsors want us to think that this only sort of makes it a crime to wear a mask, or maybe doesn't even really make it a crime to wear a mask for health and safety reasons, kind of acting like it's no big deal to make it technically a crime, but say, oh, it's probably not going to be punished anyway, and that we can just trust that no one who still wears a mask in public will be harassed or stopped. But that's wrong. That's not how laws work. To be clear, and this is verified by legal staff who we go to, all of us as legislators, to ask what the intent, what the effect of a bill is. They have told me in writing, very opposite of what Senator Britt just had to say, that this bill makes it a class one misdemeanor to wear a mask for the purpose of protecting one's health and safety or that of others. You don't have to have any other action necessary to make it a class one misdemeanor, which, by the way, is the most serious level of misdemeanor. And I can cite you that it's General Statute 14-12.15, making it a class one misdemeanor. I would also add that, of course, we need it. The reason we put the exemption in to allow people to wear a mask during COVID was because it was otherwise a crime in North Carolina. So I think, again, Senator Britt is wrong. He is, and legal staff disagrees. So we're back to it is a crime if you pass this bill. And not only would it be a crime to wear your mask during your contagious phase of an infection, for example, if this bill passes, but it's punishable. So just so you know, a class one misdemeanor punishable by 6 to 18 months probation plus a fine. That's for your first offense. If a person has one or four prior convictions, such as continuing to wear your mask in public, punishment could be 45 days in jail plus a fine. And it goes up from there. So the bill sponsor says that probably no one would be charged just for wearing a mask for their health reasons, if they're not up to other no good. But how does he know that? I'm thinking about the African-American teenager
say he has leukemia. He's wearing his mask in public. I talked to a parent today just about that. Are you so sure he won't be stopped and harassed? Because I'm not. Are you sure his mask won't be the excuse that's needed to pull him over and trigger an interaction with police? Why in the world would you make a criminal out of him or anyone else in a similar position for making the simple, common sense decision to wear a mask to keep himself and others safe? You're making careful people into criminals with this bill. It's a bad law, and you should have removed Section 1. We asked you to do that in private. We asked you in public. We just offered you two different ways to do it with amendments. You've rejected all of that. And so what I think is at foot here, unfortunately, your refusal to compromise and make this a common sense bill is that I think you want us to vote no on it so that you can then claim falsely that we somehow support masked mobs. When that's not what that's not our position at all. And I want to make that really clear. We support the right to protest. We also support the need to crack down on those who would conceal their identity and commit crimes. And we also want to protect the health of the people of North Carolina. I urge you to vote no on this bill.
Senator Chaudhry, for what purpose you rise?
Rise to offer an amendment, Mr. President.
Send forward your amendment. Clerk will read.
Senator Chaudhry moves to amend the bill.
Senator Chaudhry is recognized to explain Amendment 3.
Thank you, Mr. President. I know that our discussion thus far has focused on public health issues. I want to speak to another issue based on what Senator Newton, the bill sponsor, talked about, and that is really the idea that this bill seeks to deal with organizations and individuals who are intent on breaking the law and hiding their identity and using their identity to intimidate or disrupt other people, as he said. And if that's the goal of this legislation, then the amendment that I offer before you does two things. First, this bill, the amendment, it's vital in this amendment that we define organizations that fall within the definition of organizations that intimidate people. And when I talk about such organizations, I'm talking about hate groups. Hate groups are organizations that advocate and practice hatred, hostility, and violence towards members of a race or ethnicity or even sexual orientation. According to the North Carolina Department of Public Safety and the Federal Bureau of Investigation, we're seeing a dramatic rise in hate groups. And in fact, the Southern Poverty Law Center has identified at least 43 hate groups in our state. And just as an example, I think many of us will remember 2 years ago, a group of Proud Boys with their masks on, marched into a library in New Hanover County with the clear intent to antagonize library patrons. The sheriff's officer there told one news outlet that many of the protesters were wearing clothing with black and yellow insignia that Proud Boys traditionally wear. And so the amendment that I'm offering does what Senator Daniel suggested during a committee hearing, and that is to address the need to make sure that hate groups like the Proud Boys and Ku Klux Klan do not hide behind a mask and do not hide behind the bill's exception. This bill is consistent, this amendment, excuse me, is consistent with the title of this bill, which is really unmasking hate groups. And second, this amendment would help address the issue of hate crimes that's often tied to hate groups. We know that hate crimes like anti-Semitism have increased dramatically. Our state saw a 47% increase in reported hate crimes. This amendment would put the hate crimes prevention lack into place that would not only track hate crimes in our communities, but would provide law enforcement and prosecutors the training and tools they need to combat hate crimes often linked to hate groups. And this bill, and this provision of the amendment, has the support of a number of civil rights organizations, including the Anti-Defamation League. And so in the end, I hope this amendment, my colleagues will vote for this amendment as it seeks to protect our citizens from hate. I urge you to vote for this amendment.
Discussion or debate on Amendment 3. Senator Heiss, for what purpose you rise?
To move that Amendment 3 do live on the table.
Second.
Moved and seconded that Amendment 3 do lie upon the table. It's a non-debatable motion. We'll go immediately to vote. Question for the Senate is the motion to table Amendment 3. All in favor of the motion to vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting clerk. Record the vote. Britt, aye. Having voted in the affirmative, 15 in the negative, the motion does carry and Amendment 3 is tabled and the bill is back before us. Discussion or debate on second reading for House Bill 237. Senator Blue, for what purpose you rise?
To debate the bill.
You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I will be brief. I just, in listening to the points made by my colleagues during this debate, some things quickly come to mind because I think that we sort of get esoteric sometimes, want to speak above what we're really talking about. I was thinking about Senator Britt and his explanation, and I just happened to be reading the staff explanation of this bill. And it says Section 1 of the bill would repeal a specific law and individuals would no longer be able to wear a mask in public for health or safety reasons. So it seems an absolute ban on wearing masks. And if we're putting a ban on it, we ought not give people the discretion to break the law. The law is a law, and we ought to ask people to observe all aspects of it. So even if nobody would bother them, we're encouraging them to pick and choose the laws that they want to obey, which is a bad thing to do. Secondly, just to share an experience with you, in my church, which has an elderly congregation, as most churches do now, we were convincing people to come back to church. And overwhelmingly, they would say, well, I'm going to wear a mask. Yeah, I'll invite any of you to come to church with me on Sunday mornings, and you'll see a significant number of people in the pews wearing masks because we went through an experience 2 years ago, 3 years ago, that nobody had been through in 100 years. So we didn't have anybody to tell us about it. You know, my grandparents didn't tell me about it, and they lived through the 1918 pandemic. And it had such an effect on them that they didn't really talk about it. I don't know. Some of you may have talked to people who talked about the 1918-1919 pandemic. So we went through this experience 2 or 3 years ago, and a lot of people are still recovering from it. You'll be amazed at how many people, when they get a little cough or something, or they self-test, who put on a mask to protect everybody that they come in contact with. And the medical information is, if you in fact have contracted COVID, then you keep yourself away from people for 5 days, and after then you wear a mask, and you're protecting them. You're not contagious to them. If you've been to most of the Asian countries, any of the Asian countries, especially those in the southern part of Asia, it is a common practice for people to wear a mask. And as we started going into COVID, I started looking around because I'd seen them in those countries wearing masks, and I wondered, you know, how do people get along wearing masks like this? But the further we got into COVID, the more you saw Americans doing what they were doing in Asian countries, wearing masks for safety. And that's not just physical safety, but for comfort of mind, to know that they weren't going to get exposed and they weren't exposing anybody else. You go to some ball games now, I don't care whether it's even baseball in an outside stadium, basketball, hockey, people wear masks. They still wear them. They don't have any evil intent in wearing them. They want to protect themselves and their neighbors. They urge kids to wear them in the summertime or in the wintertime if they got a little sniffle. because we learned during COVID that the incidence of flu went down because kids were wearing masks and adults were wearing masks. So there's some health reasons for this. The other thing that occurs to me is that you see these Muslim ladies, worshipers, wearing the jabib, however you pronounce it. I think that's the way, nabib, that's the way you pronounce it. Majab, that's what it is. I'm getting it right. As part of their religious custom. That is a mask. It's concealing their face. Should we be banning them from wearing the costume of their religion? Probably not. And so the last point that I will raise with you in trying to look at some of the practical implications of this is that if you're riding down the road wearing a mask because you've been sort of held up in your house for several days, maybe you're going to the supermarket or somewhere else. If you got the mask on and it's against the law to be wearing a mask, you've created probable cause for any police officer to stop you. And he or she can stop you for any reason, even if they think that there's something else that you've done. And it cuts against the basic liberties on which this country was founded. We trust police. I mean, I'm just like you. I thank them for all they do. I'm celebrating National Law Enforcement Week. But we got the Fourth Amendment in our Constitution to guarantee that we are free from unreasonable searches and seizures. And we create opportunities for an abuse of that. And it doesn't matter whether it's widely abused, if it's just abused, because the police officer can't search your car, he can't do anything to you unless he observes you breaking the law or suspects with a high probability that you are breaking the law. If you got the mask on, you're showing him you're breaking the law and him or her that you're breaking the law. And it just seems to be an infringement on the liberties that we all hold so dear. And I know that we get involved and caught up in the emotion of the period that we're in, that we want to send signals that everybody who wears a mask might somewhere or other be up to some criminal intent. Our whole structure of the protections in society and our Constitution is built around protecting those kinds of liberties from people who want to think that you're doing something that you're not doing. We are very expressive people. We're the freest people on the face of the earth. And I don't see why we ought to ban people from protecting themselves, protecting their neighbors, when there's no likely reason to think that they're breaking the law. And the only way that they're breaking it is because we're now making it illegal to do what people have become accustomed to doing. And I said last, but really lastly, we had an entire industry that grew up around COVID-19. Some of them operate in North Carolina. People are still manufacturing N95 masks because they have a value. I was using them extensively before COVID occurred because I have allergies. And anytime I go cut grass or spending time before I take medication on the outside, I'm wearing masks. I wear them to the gas station and I wear them around. And I don't have any criminal intent, I don't think. I'm just saying that we need to take note of what people do and the customs that we've come to practice because of what we went through 2 or 3 years ago. And you haven't heard from them yet, but all of the people that I've just talked about are going to be calling you wanting to know why they can't wear their mask anymore. It may have been impermissible before COVID, but they've gotten used to it. And the average person doesn't keep up with what all the laws are. But they will know when you start talking about you can't wear a mask anymore. So I ask you to rethink this thing. I don't know what ultimately you're trying to achieve. But if you're just trying to ban masks for the sake of banning them, I don't think that there is a good reason for it. If you've ever been out in dusty situations and fields and stuff like that, you ride your tractor, you wear a mask. Regardless of where you're driving it to, I think you do. You probably do if you wise, you would. So I say that we're plowing down this field, not mixing metaphors. You're plowing down this field without really knowing what all the implications are. And again, I don't know what the ulterior motive is, if there is one. Maybe we're just overly eager to address a problem that doesn't exist. But I hope that you'll rethink this and at least make it clear that people have liberty and they have the freedom to wear masks if they want to. They don't have the freedom to wear a mask and commit a crime. And that's the way that this was first presented, that they'd only be punished when they broke the law and they were wearing a mask. But this is making wearing a mask in and of itself a crime in North Carolina. And I hope you don't do it.
Members, we are now past 5 o'clock, so and the pages are to be dismissed at 5 o'clock or as close to that as we can get. So the pages are dismissed for the day. Thank you for being with us today. Senator Buck Newton, for what purpose your eyes?
Speak to the bill.
You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate the comments from my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, my friends. I appreciate having a conversation with Senator Batch after a committee meeting the other day when this question of protecting hate groups came up. You know, we had a good conversation, and unfortunately, at that point, time did not allow to dive into it deeply at that moment. But since then, I've had the chance to do that, Senator Batch. And at first reading, at first glance, the section you were referring to does sort of read as if it might offer some protections, but it doesn't. The KKK is a secret society, and it's illegal in North Carolina. They wouldn't be able to utilize that section at all. So it's a mistake. And I understand why it appeared that way. I at first thought, as you may recall from our discussion, I was concerned about that, but we did a deeper dive and understanding, and they're simply illegal anyway, so they wouldn't be able to take advantage of that section. So that's one of the first things I wanted to clear up for the members and for the public, that in no way does this bill protect a hate group like the KKK. And if there's further need to clean up that language, if there had been a need to clean up that language, I'm sure Senator Blue, when he came into the House and probably, I think, 79 or 80 or somewhere on there, and since that time would have found a way to clean that up if it somehow was protecting the KKK, which I'm certain that it does not. There, all of the discussions that we've heard from the other side, from my friends, and the amendments that have been offered, there seems to be a fundamental misunderstanding of what this bill does and how the law operates. And it's no wonder that so many folks are scared. I heard some of the comments from one of my colleagues about what the real motivations are, and I think some of us are wondering what the real motivations are of folks on the other side of the aisle scaring the bejesus out of everybody, making them feel like if they have a need at times to wear masks because they're immunocompromised, that somehow they're going to get arrested. What I want my members and the public to understand is that this was the law for more than 50 years. And since we've had committee, we've even done tried to do a deep dive, and we can find no case of any prosecution of anybody trying to wear a mask for a health reason. We do, you know, this bill This bill addresses wearing a mask for the purpose of hiding your identity. Those are the criminal statutes that are referenced. Even DHHS recognizes that. But if we communicate to the public a false notion, of course they're going to be scared. Of course they're going to be fearful. That certainly is not my intent. Is it yours? I think that folks that want to be objective and understand about what's going on in our society today only have to watch the news at night to understand what the purpose of this bill is. There's a whole crowd of people out there that are running around taking advantage of this mask hangover from when we had the pandemic and using it as an opportunity to do things that they shouldn't be doing, say things that they shouldn't do, intimidate people in public places, smash and grab all over the place. This bill addresses those situations. This bill addresses those situations. For 50 years, this was the law or more. I'm not aware of any case law or motions to suppress for unlawful stops because somebody was wearing a mask. Just because they were wearing a mask because they were worried about somebody at home, understandably, or maybe worried about themselves. This bill does not criminalize wearing a mask for any purpose other than to hide your identity. What are we trying to hide? What are we trying to hide? If I had an anecdote, we'd be here all night for all the phone calls and attaboys that I've gotten from law enforcement and everyday folks saying it's about time. It's about time that the craziness is put, at least slowed down, if not put to a stop. We all know what this is about. Somebody mentioned politics. I smell politics on the other side of the aisle when they're scaring people to death about a bill that is only going to criminalize people who are trying to hide their identity so they can do something wrong. Members, I ask you to seriously think about this. I ask you to vote for the bill. Thank you.
Further discussion or debate? Senator Lowe, for what purpose you rise?
To ask the bill sponsor a question.
Senator Newton? Do you yield?
I will.
He yields.
Do you know who I am with this mask on?
Senator Lowe, I would recognize you by your voice and your gait, and I absolutely know who you are with this mask on. I also know that if I asked you to, because I wasn't sure who you were, you would show me who you are, because I know you're not up to anything with an ulterior wrong motive.
Follow up.
I yield.
He yields.
I've been an African-American for almost 65 years now. And my mother and my grandmother and my father and my grandfather taught me how to know who people were, whether they had a Klan uniform on or not. We knew by their actions. I respect this chamber. I really, really do. There's even something in the rules against using props. This was a prop. But I respect this chamber. And the
Senator Lowe, is there a question there?
Yeah, I'm coming to it.
Okay.
The thing I don't understand is why would we reduce ourselves and I'm asking this to the bill sponsor, to discuss and argue about a mask. Because we know who people are, whether they have on a mask or not. I don't know what the real intent is, but I know you're going to tell me. But this is ridiculous. It really is.
Thank you, Senator Lowe. Just as I've said before, it is to unmask people who are trying to hide their identities. And there are plenty of people doing it. I noticed one of the amendments that was offered, it was defined in such a way when it was talking about groups. It wouldn't have covered Antifa. Antifa is one of the prime groups out there these days who love to be masked in their uniform with their helmets, head to toe. Can't figure out who they are. Don't know if they belong. Don't know what the purpose is other than to clearly intimidate people. Senator Lowe, in a different context, you could intimidate me, but not by wearing a mask. I know who you are. I think well of you, and I think you're a fine fella. And I want you personally to know. I'm not sure what I said was so funny, but I'm sure you'll tell me after session. Okay.
Senator Newton, are you still answering his question?
I'm trying to answer his question. Thank you, Senator Berger.
If we can move it along.
The purpose is simply to make it clear that you're not going to get away with hiding your identity if you're up to no good.
Further discussion or debate? Senator Marcus, what purpose your eyes?
To ask the bill sponsor a question.
Senator Newton, do you yield?
I'll yield for one question.
He yields for one question.
Make it a good one then. Okay. Going off what you said earlier in defense of this bill, saying that it only applies if someone is up to no good or committing a crime or trying to conceal their identity. If it wasn't illegal to wear a mask in public prior to COVID, why did we pass the specific exemption when we did that made it legal to wear a mask for the purpose of ensuring the physical health or safety of the wearer or others? Why did we have to put that in statute if it wasn't illegal?
Thank you, Senator Marcus. Thank you, Mr. President. Senator Marcus, frankly, I wasn't here when that was passed, and so I frankly have no idea what this body was thinking. Somebody else might be able to answer that question. As I sit here today, with the benefit of hindsight, if I had been here then, I probably would have voted no.
Senator Bash, for what purpose your eyes?
To speak to the bill a second time.
You have the floor.
I appreciate Senator Newton saying that he wants to work with me, and we try to work on language. I do think that the language that I presented today and the amendment that he specifically spoke to with law enforcement officers coming upon someone that they may not recognize to go ahead and identify themselves. The amendment that was tabled earlier today and not considered was actually specifically citing the fact that law enforcement would have the ability to ask that individual to remove their mask for identification purposes. I'd also say that, again, whether it's the Ku Klux Klan, whether it's the Proud Boys, whether it's Antifa, the entire purpose of and the challenges that I have already brought up with regards to this bill is that we are protecting hate groups and we are not protecting those that are immunocompromised. So whether it is what you say it to be, Senator Newton, that is not what staff presented in committee yesterday with regards to the Ku Klux Klan and said that it was absolutely okay for them to walk down the street so long as county commissioners in the state allowed them to do that. What I would also say to you is there are other groups, and there will be groups for the rest of time who will fearmonger and who will hate others, whether it's the color of their religion, their gender, their sexual orientation, or simply the color of their skin. And I would just be remiss without closing to say that those of us who have literally fought for our lives and are immunocompromised are not fear-mongering. My remarks on this floor are not to fear-monger. I believe all of you know me well enough to know I only stand up when I have something that I think is relevant and important to say. I don't filibuster. I don't randomly speak on things that I do not know. What I do know is that myself and many other North Carolinians are afraid because I am a law-abiding citizen. I am an attorney. And the way in which the bill summary and staff has stated is that if I choose to wear a mask, then I will be breaking the law. So I have to face a decision, and so does everyone else in North Carolina, with protecting themselves or their loved ones or being charged with a class one misdemeanor.
Further discussion or debate? Hearing none, question for the Senate is passage on second reading of House Bill 237. All in favor will vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Thirty having voted in the affirmative, 15 in the negative. House Bill 237 has passed its second reading and will, without objection, be read a third time.
The General Assembly of North Carolina enacts.
Discussion or debate on third reading? Hearing none, question for the Senate is a passage on third reading of House Bill 237. All in favor will say aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and House Bill 237 has passed its third reading and will be returned to the House on the issue of concurrence. Conference report for adoption, Senate Bill 542. The clerk will read.
Senate Bill 542, DOL Omnibus, Other Changes.
Senator Gailey is recognized to explain the motion.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would encourage everyone to vote in favor of the motion to adopt the conference report. The vast majority of this bill, the Department of Labor omnibus bill, was passed by this body on May the 1st of 2023. We sent it over to the House. It passed this body unanimously. We sent it to the House, and it's had a long journey, but it's back, and the majority of it is exactly the same as we sent it over to the House. There is one small addition at the end that addresses what preferred vendor for purposes of state contracts, that there will not be a preferred vendor for elevators. There can be a preferred vendor in other areas, but not for elevators. So I ask you to vote in support of the motion, please.
Discussion or debate? Hearing none, question for the Senate is the motion to adopt the conference report to Senate Bill 542. All in favor will vote aye. All opposed, vote no. 5 seconds be allowed for the voting. Clerk, record the vote. Senator Britt? Aye. 45 having voted in the affirmative, none in the negative. The conference report is adopted and the House will be notified. Members, upon the motion of Senator Mayfield of Buncombe County, the chair is happy to extend courtesies to Kelly Antunes. She is the mother of Senate Page Bella Antunes and also of Benjamin Antunes. Bella's baby brother. If you're in the gallery, if you'd please stand to be recognized. Thank you for being with us today. Members, I believe that completes our calendar. Are there any notices or announcements? Senator Chodry, for what purpose your eyes?
Mr. President, I'd like to change my vote from aye to no for House Bill 198.
House Bill 198, Senator Chodry, from aye to no. Final vote, 34 in favor, 14 opposed. Other notices or announcements? Senator Woodard, for what purpose your eyes?
Moment of personal privilege.
You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President.
big New York Yankee fans like me and Senator Berger could regale you with stories about why Lou Gehrig was the Iron Man of baseball and the many records that Lou Gehrig held and what an inspirational player he was. But perhaps his greatest lasting legacy was living with ALS early and being probably one of the first and most visible examples of someone living with that awful disease. I have a senatorial statement that I want to call your attention to at your desks today. Every 90 minutes, someone passes away from ALS, and yet another person is diagnosed with this progressive fatal disease. This is the 10th anniversary of the Ice Bucket Challenge. Maybe some of you participated in it. I did as well, and which led to significant investments in research and heightened awareness of this disease. The ALS Association has committed $154 million to 550 current research projects, some of which are right here in North Carolina's medical schools and universities. The statement points out that May is ALS Awareness Month and encourages all North Carolinians to support ALS research projects, and stand in solidarity with those afflicted and their families. And I commend this statement to you. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Woodard. Don't want to shortchange Senator Lowe. I believe he's been seen with a Yankees hat himself. So, Senator Lowe, for what purpose you rise?
Point of personal privilege.
You have the floor.
Yes, I am a Yankee fan and a Knicks fan. I do want to thank this body for all of your gestures of kindness. On Monday, we laid my mother to rest where she rests right next to her mother there in Seattle. So many of you, I'm not going to call names at all, but, you know, just shared in so many beautiful and important ways, and your gestures of kindness and prayers will never be forgotten. God bless you and thank you.
Further notices or announcements? Is there further business come for the Senate? If not, Senator Heiss is recognized for a motion.
Thank you once again, Mr. President. I move that the Senate do now adjourn, subject to the provisions of Senate Rule 24.1, to reconvene on Thursday, May 16th, 2024 at 9:30 a.m. This will be a non-voting session. Members, there will be no votes taken tomorrow.
Motion is that the Senate do now adjourn, subject to the stipulation stated by Senator Heiss, to reconvene on Thursday, May 16th, 2024 at 9:30 a.m. Seconded by Senator Lowe, all in favor will say aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the Senate stands adjourned.
There you have it, word for word. Thanks for watching. See you next time.